Welcome to another video by The Financial Controller. My name is Bill Hanna, and I've been in the accounting game for the last 15 years. And if you're new to this channel, what we do here, we discuss interesting finance concepts and accounting fraud cases and career advice as well. So if you're in finance, go ahead and subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss out on the videos that we put out weekly. Today's video is about Luck & Coffee and the fraud that occurred in 2020. And just like we do for other accounting fraud cases in this channel, like Enron, WorldCom, and all the other cases that we discussed in the past, what we like to do is go through the timeline of events from founding the company in 2017 to all of the events that are unfolding now in the middle of 2020, as well as go through the story of the company in terms of value proposition. What is the company offering that the competition doesn't have? What differentiates their business model? So we'll do that for Luck & Coffee. And then at the end of the video, I'm gonna go through what I think happened, what are the signs and the telltale signs of the story, who might be the culprit and the perpetrator of this fraud. So without further ado, let's dive right in. Okay, so a quick background on the company. Luck & Coffee was founded in 2017 by Jenny Tian. She comes from her background is in the ride-hailing industry or the ride-sharing industry. And what she noticed is that she was working late and consuming lots of coffee, and so were her coworkers as well. So she began to notice that there is this adoption of coffee drinking in China, where historically and traditionally, the consumers in China consume more tea than coffee. She observed that on average, the average consumer in China would consume about 6 cups per year, compared to the West or in the United States, where the consumption is about 300 cups per year. So she noticed the difference between the 6 and the 300 cups, and noticed there could be a big upside and a growth story here that she might be part of. So Luck & Coffee was born, and its first store was opened in Beijing in 2017. And the strategy that the company had was based on Jenny Tian's history or experience with ride sharing or ride hailing. So the first strategy that she saw here is that mobile first, meaning that consumers are conducting their transactions using their mobile phones more than anything else. And so the difference here between Luck & Coffee and a Starbucks would be that you're buying your coffee beforehand on your mobile phone and just walking in into the kiosk or the store and just grabbing your coffee and go on your merry way. That was the first strategy. And the second was also based on her days from the ride hailing industry, which is to gain market share fast by offering deep discounts. So at Luck & Coffee, they were offering discounts. For example, to get a latte, you can get one for about 20 RMB, whereas to get that from a Starbucks would be twice that price at least. And so these were the two pillars of the strategy that they were using to gain market share in China. And by 2019, the company had 4,900 locations, and that was officially bigger than the number of location of Starbucks. And with this enormous level of growth, Luck & Coffee filed for an IPO in 2019 in the month of May, and they were trading publicly under the ticker symbol LK in the NASDAQ. And they weren't making any money yet. Obviously, this is a new startup and they were losing money. For example, in Q3 of 2019, they had losses of about $73 million, obviously because they were spending so much money on sales and marketing, as well as offering deep discounts in their products. So they were turning a huge loss toward the end of 2019. Now we take a look at the events that unfolded in 2020. And this began in January of 2020 with a short seller, a famous short seller by the name of Muddy Waters Research, that published an article saying that they received an anonymous tip that told them that Luck & Coffee basically is a fraud and that all the sales numbers are fabricated and made up. And immediately after that article came out, Luck & Coffee came out and denied these allegations very strongly. And then a couple of months went by, and then in April of 2020, Luck & Coffee admitted to the fraud. So they came out and they said that they conducted an internal investigation and found that there were $310 million in revenue that were made up or never existed. And immediately when that admission was made, the stock took a huge dip and went down by 75% in a single day, wiping out about $5 billion, that's five with a B, of shareholder value in a single day. And then that was in April of 2020. And the interesting thing is that when Luckin Coffee admitted to the fraud on April of 2020, they pinned it all on one person, which was the chief operating officer, Liu Jian. And basically, he was fired from his job. And just a month later, in May of 2020, the board decided to fire Jenny Tian, who was the co-founder and CEO. Basically, the idea is that if you are the chief executive officer, even though you're not part of the actual fraud itself, but at least you should have known, you should run the ship much tighter than that. And so she was basically fired from her post as a CEO. And then in June of 2020, the Nasdaq decides to delist Luckin Coffee from being publicly traded on their platform. And obviously, that's because of the Chinese authorities are investigating Luckin Coffee for the fraud, and also because Luckin Coffee failed to file for the annual report. And I imagine that's because Luckin Coffee is still going through their books and records and trying to clean up the income numbers or the revenue numbers. And so the Nasdaq decided to delist him in June of 2020. And then immediately after, Luckin Coffee requested a hearing with the Nasdaq. And the purpose of the hearing is for Luckin Coffee to present a plan for compliance for the future. And the plan will be to show how they plan to clean the books and records, and also how they plan to clean up the team and have more strict corporate governance over the process of revenue recognition. But this hearing was set to happen toward the end of June. But then an interesting thing happened is that Luckin Coffee withdrew its request for having that hearing. And I imagine that's because they weren't ready yet to have that meeting and present the plan. They probably are still working on it. And you can tell that that's the case because immediately after, Luckin Coffee launched its internal investigation to figure out who's involved in the fraud and whether there are other people within the company involved in the fraud. Now, the interesting thing about the internal investigation that's being conducted by Luckin Coffee right now is that even though the final reports are not out yet from the investigation, but the preliminary results are indicating the potential implication of the chairman of the board, Liu Jianguo, in this fraud. Basically, the report is finding that the third-party companies that were used to fabricate the revenue, the $300 million revenue, these third-party companies are owned by someone who was a classmate or a schoolmate of Liu Jianguo, the chairman of the board. And based on that, the investigation board is recommending that the board of directors would meet at some point in the month of July to vote on the possible removal of the chairman of the board, Liu Jianguo. Now that we talked about the history of the company and the timeline of events that took place, I want to spend some time talking about the observations that I have about the events in terms of accounting and corporate governance. Now, the first thing I want to discuss is ownership, because the founder of the company and the CEO of the company that was fired in May, Jenny Tian, owns 20% stake in the company, and Liu Jianguo, the chairman of the board of directors, owns 30% of the company. Compared to Liu Jian, who basically was the fall guy who took the fall for the fraud initially in April, and he owns options. And basically, stock options are a financial instrument that gives you the possibility to buy stock in the future. And in his case, in the COO's case, his options, if they were to be exercised, they would amount to less than 1% ownership in the company. So this is one of the things that jumps right at me from this case, is that the ownership by the chairman of the board and the CEO is so much larger than the COO who took the fall. So basically, this guy here, Liu Jian, the COO, took the fall for this revenue fraud, and basically he owns less than 1%. Something here doesn't add up, and it hints to me toward more of an involvement from the people who have more skin in the game, which is the CEO and the chairman of the board. Now, the second thing that I noticed about this case is the chairman's involvement in the business. So Liu Jianguo is the chairman of the board, and typically, as a chairman of the board of directors, your involvement in the business shouldn't be in the day-to-day activity and directing revenue transactions. Basically, your involvement should be high level and strategic in nature in driving the business forward. So this is another telltale sign hinting toward the problem in corporate governance if there is a involvement from the chairman of the board of directors and the day-to-day activity. Now, the third observation I have here is the involvement of third-party companies and the fraud that was committed. And basically, the internal investigation that's going on right now is trying to figure out the extent of the involvement of third-party companies in this fraud, and basically the involvement from Lu Zhengyao and these third-party companies. As we mentioned, the owner of these third-party companies is a classmate of Lu Zhengyao, so it'll be very interesting to figure out and to find out soon in this investigation the extent of his involvement in this case. And the fourth thing I want to discuss is IPO readiness, because basically, as you can see from the timeline, Luck & Coffee went from founding in 2017 to going public in 2 years, while the average company, usually a startup today, takes about 11 years to go public. And the reason why it takes so long is because it takes time for a company to establish its internal controls, its functions, its teams, its internal audit and processes in place so that you can go public. Because basically when you go public, your responsibility extends to much more than the small group of investors that you began the company with, and extends to the public that's investing in your stock on the stock exchange. And so I think that the company here went way too fast in under 2 years from founding to going public. And that is another problem in this story. The company should wait a little longer and establish its processes, its audits, and put everything in place for going public. And I think that's one of the major flaws in this story here. So this was a quick recap of the story and all we know today. There will most likely be another part of this video, because right now there's the internal investigation that's going on, and we also want to figure out whether Luck & Coffee will find a way to relist again on the NASDAQ stock exchange. So most likely I'll do another follow-up video in the future, so stay tuned for that. But if you like this video, please give a thumbs up, and if you haven't subscribed to the channel, go ahead and subscribe so that you don't miss out on any of the videos that I put out weekly, and I'll see you in the next one.